はい、皆さん
今まで ROG のマザーボードを使います、 ROG のケースを使います、 ROG の電源を使います。But on a serious note, these glasses, they turn everything red. They're absolutely phenomenal. It's like you're breathing a new life into you. So we've just finished building this gaming PC right here, and you may notice that there's no graphics card. And this is actually a reality of what is going on in anticipation of RTX 3000. I'm speaking to a lot of different computer shops, and there are a lot of people coming in and just getting everything but the GPU. And my answer to this is, if prices are good on all components right now, except the GPU and except the CPU, because you may wish to also think about holding out for Zen 3, which is also right around the corner. So that's hopefully going to bring some improvements on the AMD side of CPUs. And so if you can get all these other components like the SSD, the RAM, the motherboard, the cooler, the case, the power supply, and they're pretty good prices, where I feel going forward, especially when these graphics cards, the RTX 3080s, come back into stock, and also the new Zen 3 CPUs are released, you've only really got upside risk of all these other components going up in price when these launches happen. So my suggestion would be, if you can afford to get all the other components right now, and you are 100% certain that you're going to be getting an RTX 3080 build happening, then it is certainly not a bad idea to go get an RTX 3080 ready PC in the works. But also right now, one thing we're going to check out, which you guys have requested, is an undervolting guide to see how the RTX 3080 stacks up in terms of performance when you undervolt it versus its out-of-the-box settings. Now, I recently took a look at the Tough Gaming, and this thing was very impressive out of the box, as well as when you overclocked it. I'll put the link to that review up here if you want to check it out. So let's quickly chuck this thing into an Intel test bed and then chuck it into an AMD test bed to see not only how it undervolts, but also we'll be comparing some figures against the CPU that we're putting in here, the 3800 XT versus the 3950X versus the Intel 10900K. And here we are, just finishing up with undervolting this GPU. Now, I was shocked at how much better the GPU was in terms of efficiency after doing this, and we really didn't lose any FPS at all. In fact, the worst case scenario we saw was Shadow of the Tomb Raider, where we went from 83 to 81 FPS, and then Horizon Zero Dawn, we lost 1 FPS, and then Doom Eternal, we lost 1 FPS as well. However, the power consumption in some cases was going near 100 watts less draw, and this is pretty much for similar FPS. So big thanks to you guys in the comments, and also the GPU report, they're a Czech publication, and they just basically showed what settings they had to give the best results in their video, and I just pretty much copy-pasted that because it's gonna save me a lot of time. So essentially you just jump into MSI Afterburner, and then you can just hold shift and drag the whole curve down. So the max part is at 1800 megahertz roughly. Then you can raise up the 805 millivolt section up to 1800 megahertz, lock that in and give it a go. And that's exactly what worked on my settings. I pretty much just copy pasted it off this video. So full credit to the GPU report for that trick. And then of course your power consumption is going to be a lot less. When I first started seeing it from the wall, I was like, whoa, is this for real? And this is definitely one of those times where you will want to undervolt. And this is easily the biggest difference I've seen with undervolting for this card. It's quite impressive. Okay. So now we finished up with the 3950X overclocked to 4.3 gigahertz, tested that against the 3800XT versus the 10900K across three different games here at 4K to see what kind of a difference it makes. And you're really only losing a couple of FPS going from Ryzen to Intel. But of course, if we start dropping the resolutions in certain games, there may be bigger differences. So it all depends on what you want to do. But basically what we're seeing just from that test alone is that PCIe Gen 4 is not going to make a big difference, at least for an RTX 3080. But I will be making a separate video for PCIe Gen 3 versus 4, because I've got some other interesting tests that I want to do with that. And I'm thinking something along the lines of a Xeon. However, you may notice from the B-roll that ASUS and Kingston sent over some of their parts, and ASUS sent over their ROG line of case, power supply, cooler, and also their motherboard. And they wanted me to take a look at it and stress test it and basically see if it's RTX 3080 ready. Same with Kingston. They've got some really nice DDR4 memory here and also their KC2500 SSD, which is a real value-oriented line of NVMe SSD. The Kingston DDR4 RGB memory, this stuff, we had 4 sticks of this for 32 gigabytes in total. Honestly, if I was going with a RTX 3080 or 3090 build, I would opt for the 32 gigabytes over 16 gigabytes, even if the 16 gigabyte kits were a little bit faster, because some of the games now, especially if you've got all these other applications open and you're playing games, you may need more than 16 gigabytes. So this stuff here, 3600 megahertz XMP, it locked in with 4 sticks, absolutely fine with the 3950X and also the 3800XT. So the compatibility's there through the ASUS motherboard, the Kingston memory, and the CPU's IMC, it's all good to go. But in the meantime, we'll check out things like this motherboard right here, which is the B550 Strix F. And testing this out with a 3950X, even though we're using a 3800XT in today's build, which is pretty much all you're gonna need for 4K gaming, once you get 8 cores, 16 threads, you're gonna be absolutely fine. Another thing about the 3800XT too, is that it has higher clock speeds than the 3950X, and it's actually more of a capable overclocker, especially for games, it will do a slightly better job than the 3950X. However, this motherboard, we're coming in with VRM temperatures that are under 70 degrees, even with a 3950X that's overclocked to 4.3 gigahertz. And now this thing is drawing 250 watts direct draw power. So I'm loading up this VRM with a lot of heat, and this motherboard and its design is doing a really good job. So if you want something that'll handle everything now and even a Zen 3 highest end processor later overclocked, then this motherboard is certainly not going to disappoint. Now onto the memory, we did load this up 3600 megahertz over 32 gigabytes across 4 DIMMs. And on the Cinebench scores, you may notice that they're usually slightly higher. And so having 4 DIMMs as opposed to 2 DIMMs at 3600 megahertz, same speeds, will actually give you a slight performance improvement. As we can see with these Cinebench R20 scores, where usually at these clock speeds, I'll just etch over 10,000 points. And we see here we're etching over a lot of the times 10,100 points. As for the onboard audio, they're using the Realtek 1220 with surprisingly a pretty powerful headphone amplifier, which will do a great job to pretty much any mid-range cans. Though, looking at the frequency response curve, 0 to 10 Hz, we only had a minus 1.2 decibel roll-off, and then the rest of the frequency response line was pretty much perfectly flat. Looking at crosstalk numbers, they were at minus 88 decibels, even at 100 volume. However, other things that are checking out on this B550 motherboard is the heatsink designs. Because we don't have PCIe 4.0 on the chipset, but it's just directly to the CPU, we don't therefore need a fan on the heatsink. And also the M.2 temperatures are really well controlled. And the speeds, at least in this case, we had a PCIe Gen 3 SSD, those speeds were absolutely fine in conjunction with this motherboard. But keep in mind, you can get PCIe Gen 4 SSDs and they will go even faster. But look at the USB 3 speeds, the NIC speeds, those were all fine when I tested them, but you've also got Wi-Fi 6 included if you wish to use that over a traditional Ethernet cable. So the motherboard in today's build is probably my favorite piece. However, moving on to the case, this is the Helios. This thing straight away is a really heavy case. It's got these straps on the top, which I actually use them to carry the PC around if I've got to move it. I would have to say that it's a little bit too big for my liking, but it does have tempered glass all around on the sides and the front actually lights up the glass, which is a pretty cool look. Though the most important thing with the case, especially when you're going with a higher end build, is the temperatures and more importantly, the airflow. And so testing out this case, where they've actually gone with four 140 mil fans that are non-RGB, these fans do a pretty good job, especially when it comes to remaining quiet and also pushing through airflow. And so when we loaded up the RTX 3080 TUF and we stress tested this GPU with Furmark with the glass on versus off. And what we saw here was that having the glass on really only gave us a 1 degree drop, which means that the case itself is designed pretty well. And since the RTX 3080 TUF is dumping a lot of heat just directly in the case, having airflow is an important thing. So although the case is really heavy and quite expensive, it does do its job that it's set out to do. But the Strix power supply, that did a really good job. If you want to go with an RTX 3080 or even 3090, then this power supply is going to give you more juice than you could ever imagine. As well as you want to overclock, say a 3950X and overclock your graphics card, this power supply will be able to provide all the watts needed to do that. Though I will say one thing about the Ryujin 240, although it's going to be absolutely fine for a 3800XT and even a 3900X, when it comes to a 3950X overclocked, the temperatures were going a little bit higher than I'd be comfortable with. So I've said this with the 10900K and also the 3950X. If you want to go with either of these CPUs in your main rig, I would personally go for a 280 mil solution or a 360, where I feel like they just do that bit better of a job. Especially when you're overclocking, you want to get the most out of your gear and your power supply and motherboard can support it. And those few extra degrees make all the difference. So now it's time to conclude the whole video. And basically, if you want to get a RTX 3080 ready gaming PC, then by all means, go find the deals, go get the good stuff and build it up now in anticipation of the RTX 3080. Because from all the tests that I've done here, coupled with the 120 Hertz 4K OLED experience, I am really, really enjoying this stuff. It's, for me, it's just a whole new world of PC gaming. And I think, and it's honestly for the rare few at the moment who are on this combo, they will be able to vouch for it and tell you how good it is at the moment. I really am enjoying PC gaming again. I just want to go back now and play through a lot of games that I've sidelined because of beforehand just not really enjoying myself on these monitors. And I've always been a fan of gloss, and I've always been a fan of proper backlighting for your eyes. And so these OLEDs just have all of that combined with the 4K 120 Hertz 10-bit factor. Anyway, enough of that rambling aside. Basically, if you can't get an RTX 3080 for now, then you might want to put in a 5700 XT. And you're probably thinking, why a 5700 XT? And so on the used market, this graphics card has the best resale value, believe it or not. And that's because it's the most in-demand card for cryptocurrency miners, where if they're cheap enough, they'll pick up a 5700 XT or two and then put them on mining where they can tune them and make them more efficient. Where the RTX 3080 really, it's not as appealing as the 5700 XT, especially at the moment where it's going over those MSRP prices. Though don't worry, I'm sure the crypto miners are sitting there waiting for these cards to come up at MSRP so they can snatch them up. But in the meantime, if you want to play some games and you're in waiting in the queue, the 5700 XT is going to give you really good frame rates for now. And then when you're ready and when RTX 3080s are in stock and they're at decent prices, then you can trade that over and resell your 5700 XT. And you should be getting some really good value for your dollar still and playing games in the meantime. Because I know a few people, I know actually quite a few people locally here have built PCs up in anticipation of getting in the first wave of 3080 and they just completely missed out. Anyway guys, if you missed out on the first wave, don't worry, there is stock coming. I talked about this in yesterday's vlog, I'll put the link up here. And with that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's video, then be sure to hit that like button for us. Also, if you're new around here and you want to see the content as soon as it drops, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell. And with that aside, we got the question of the day here, which comes from Vasily202. And they ask, my question is, does it matter that you have a 120 Hertz monitor when your GPU can only get you 67 FPS? I have an RTX 2080 Ti, I'll get the 3090 when it comes out. And in 4K, the games, Sims, I actually play a very demanding X-Plane 11 FS or Flight Simulator 2020 armor, etc. Those in 4K don't even get 60 FPS average. So what is the point of a 120 Hertz monitor to me? So to answer this question, if you're only getting 60 FPS in the games that you're playing, then yeah, there's practically no point in getting 120Hz, where you're just going to be refreshing the same frame twice. Of course, in a world of technicality, you may be drawing that frame faster than you would on a 60Hz monitor, but is 8 milliseconds really worth all that extra money? But on a serious note, if you get a 3090, you definitely will be getting a lot more FPS than a 2080 Ti, and especially if you want to delve into the world of overclocking and then play around with the settings, even in those really demanding titles, you should be able to get close to 120 FPS at 4K. And for me personally, it's really good. I'm loving it. Anyway, hope that answers that question, and I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.